You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined on this edition by a very special guest, a golden boy, you could say. It is the one and the only Charlie Anderson. Welcome to the show.
Oh, good to be here. One of the better introductions.
I work hard on
the golden boy gets.
I work very hard on them. At least that's what I remembered. There's ones that I do if I've got a guest on, I'm in the shower in the morning and go, got this amazing intro I'm going to think of. It's got all their catchphrases and everything, and then I get to the actual...
The master of disaster, the king of sting.
And then I get to the interview.
Listen off them.
Here he is.
Could just take up the full hour with that, to be honest.
How's it going, sir?
It's going good.
Excellent. So, like I was saying just before we hit record, you're a guest that you've been requested quite a few times by past guests on the show, including Legends Never Die boys. Just anyone involved with the dojo, they've wanted a bit of Charlie Anderson on the SWN podcast. So we finally got it organized. And here we are.
You finally got the man of the hour.
So we'll start from the beginning, as all good podcasters do, those cliched questions that we go through, but they're still important nonetheless. As you mentioned, I'm your first podcast, so I'm going to at least get all the base questions in, and then other podcasters could bring up like all your dark secrets. So how did you get into pro wrestling? So what was your moment watching or playing games? What was the moment that you went, wrestling, I'm having a bit of this?
To be honest, it's been as long as I can remember. I used to go to primary school, I remember me and a friend of mine, we had the planners, you know, the journal, like the regular book that you'd have, and it would just be plastered with wrestler names, but the front cover, the back cover, inside covers, and we've always said we'd do it, and never did. Probably got that was back in Ruthless Aggression era. It was like slowly turning to PG. John Cena's coming up, and then fell out of wrestling. Didn't watch it for a few years, to be honest. I missed about 10-year chunk, and then started getting back into it again. And then I was just sitting about one day, and I thought, let's see if I can message away. So I sent a message to Target Wrestling in Carlisle, and I didn't even know how to get into training, to be honest. I sent the message to the Facebook page. I was like, do you know anyone that does training for wrestlers? Anything at all like that? And there was like, you can come in on Tuesday. And I've been here ever since.
Long gone are the days. I mean, when you started watching wrestling, Ruthless Aggression, it was all a big secret. You'd have to go down to England if you wanted to train or anything. And nowadays, like you say, you can just go on, where does training near me? There you go.
If you ask, well, I didn't even Google it. I just sent the message. I saw a post pop up because I knew of Target Wrestling. And then I saw a thing pop up with the next show. I just sent them a direct message from there.
Madness. So go back to that start then, getting into the wrestling. Just before Ruthless Aggression, any favourites popped up? Who's your first like 10 names on that jotter?
It'll be surprising, actually, but my favourite as a kid was Rey Mysterio. He was always my guy. My brother was always Shawn Michaels, so he was taken. Can't have Shawn. So I went for Rey. And I remember when Great Khali, when he first turned up and Rey Mysterio was just standing like next to him, and it was that visual, I was like, everybody get in here. So Rey Mysterio, definitely. Triple H, he was always one of my favorites growing up. My mum had already claimed Randy Orton, so again, can't have him. Undertaker, obviously, Kane. Again, Edge was always a top guy when I was growing up. Yeah, I mean, the thing with that roster is, and it's the same for every roster that goes on, but the Ruthless Aggression one and the Attitude one for me are probably the strongest they've been.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I mean, I'm old enough now that I started watching through the Attitude era.
Yeah.
98, 99 is when I started watching. Actually, I felt so old because this week you get that On This Day in Wrestling things on Twitter. And it came up with like 25 years ago. This was the moment that it was Undertaker setting fire to Vince McMahon's teddy bear, but it was definitely McMahon's actually. But that was my first memory of wrestling. And then when I saw that pop up, I was like, oh God, that's a quarter of a century I've watched wrestling now. And it just made me feel so old.
It's funny as well when you watch it through and you see the guys that you absolutely despised. And then you go back now and you're like, those are my favorite ones there. Like William Regal, for me, easily one of my favorites, and hated him back in the day. JBL. I used to hate JBL. I love watching any JBL clips now.
X-Pac, for me.
Yeah.
A guy that was so vehemently hated. There was a whole genre of heat for him. And when you go back and watch him, you go, oh, man, X-Pac was great. So
yeah.
I mean, even with the Kung Fu, you know, it was still great. And some of the best theme music as well, especially X Factor, with a bit of Uncle Cracker in there.
I mean, everybody's theme song in the Attitude Era.
Oh, yeah. I mean, did you watch Royal Rumble this year? And were you just as confused when people were coming out going, I don't know who this is?
Yeah.
Oh, that's who it is. Sweet. Ace.
Yeah.
And back in the day, I could watch Royal Rumble 2000 and go, right, this is a headbanger. Sweet. Mosh is out.
I mean, even people's theme songs that didn't stick, Randy Orton's old theme song, CM Punk's old theme song, you've got, I mean, to a point, John Cena's Doctor of Thuganomics.
Oh, I liked a bit of Word Life, basic Thuganomics.
Yeah.
I had his album, it actually scratched, I've got to listen to it off Spotify, but I used to have it on CD. I bought the explicit version when it came out. Man, those were the days. anyway, so you dropped out for 10 years watching wrestling, and then just suddenly the thing came up for Target. You said you were aware of Target.
I was back into wrestling. I saw it's weird. I saw it went backwards. I didn't really immediately jump in on current stuff. I went backwards, and I ended up watching all sorts of territory things and old school World Championship Wrestling from like 1985 onwards. And I got really into that, got really into the documentary side of it. And then AEW started up. It was probably about a year in from AEW. And then I saw the Target thing. I thought, all right, I'm going for it.
How did you get into the old stuff then? Was it just a case of YouTube?
I don't know. It was just, I wanted to watch it out of nowhere. It was one of them things where I thought, oh, wrestling, I used to love that.
I was speaking about the shower way too many times in the podcast, yeah. But I was sitting in the shower just going, you know what? I heard the name Stan Hansen recently. I'm going to go just Google Stan.
Yeah, I'm just going to go and have a look at some flair matches.
Yeah, I'm just going to watch some big guys that look out of shape but can do really, really terrifying things to opponents.
Yeah. So, lots of cocaine.
Oh, yeah. A hell of a drug. I've heard. Anyway.
Allegedly. It's full of cocaine.
That's it. That's the one we use, allegedly. Throw that everywhere in wrestling.
A lot of vitamins and prayers.
So, old school stuff, Target. Did you go to Target shows, or are you aware of a independent?
I've been to two shows before I asked. To be honest, it was quite a while before I asked as well. But yeah, again, I was never really into local wrestling, never seen much of it. It was just one of the spur of the moment things. I thought I'm going for it.
I think it's one of those things where you feel it. I mean, when I started watching indie wrestling, it was tribute shows, but you make it when you see it on a post, you go, oh, it's like that WWF stuff. It's going to be all tribute rubbish. But it's one of those things when you eventually go nowadays, it's like, oh.
What I liked about it was the exact same sort of feeling as the old school wrestling that I'd gotten into. Mm-hmm. So it was like small crowds. You can get away with a lot more.
Yeah.
You know, not everything had to be massive spots and huge diving. I mean, you obviously have the odd match of that, but it's not like a WWE scale.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, the best thing about for me going to wrestling is that interaction where I can. I mean, I just went to a show this past Saturday and immediately one of the guys came out and parted like the front row just to personally insult a child in the second row.
Yeah.
I thought, yeah, you know, that WWE, do you? That's just...
And you need that as well because the kids are disgusting half the time at these wrestling shows.
I've matured quite a lot as a wrestling fan, and I sat in like that row. I was three rows back. I don't like being front row. That scares me. But third row back and watching some of these kids like throw stuff on the floor, and I'm thinking, who raised you? You need someone just.
Oh, there's nothing in the world I despise more than the wrestling fans.
I know they're terrible, all of them. Self.
You walk out of you walk out for your entrance, and you smell them before you see them.
which is a weird like kind of yin and yang, because you can smell the wrestlers come out with their tiger balm most of the time when they come out. Yeah,
deep heat's a big one.
Anything from Lush,
that's
quite popular. It's a weird experience. It's if someone asks you to describe going to a wrestling show, it's like you have to avoid using the word the smell, but it is a very unique smell.
It's an atmosphere.
That's the nice catch-all term. It's a great atmosphere.
It's just an interesting atmosphere.
Just take a peg, maybe. So getting into Target then. Did you have a sport background? Did you do anything like a combat sport at all? Anything that would kind of give
never,
you
never honestly picture? Never had any athletic background whatsoever. Never done a forward roll in my life. I remember I turned up on the first training day, and we were having to do forward rolls, backwards rolls, you know, trying to do a flip bump, suplexes, slams, running the ropes, a bunch of different pin combinations, which obviously, you know, I was never going to remember in the first day. But I remember doing it, and I feel like I took to it quite quickly, despite not ever doing anything sporty. I've always been going to the gym, you know, and things like that, but I've never done any sports or anything like that. I always hated sports at school because it didn't have wrestling. That's probably why.
I always find I don't know, I've never done it myself, but I always find that the athleticism, you can gain that, but if you don't have the coordination, that's the bit you need. You need the coordination to be able to take to the rolls, take to the footing, take to the safety aspects of it, and then the strength stuff in
it's cardio. Getting out of your own head. I think there's the main thing is it's knowing to not chicken out of a move, because at the end of the day, if you don't hit that move, you're only going to hurt yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So unless you commit 100% to everything, it's not going to work.
So for that first debut, did your friend come along as well, or did that never happen?
Not to my knowledge. If he ever does turn up, I'll go kick his ass. But no, not to my knowledge, no.
One day, the Golden Boy and the Silver Stallion. Is there anyone in your initial class that currently works for Target or elsewhere? Is there anyone else that you were...
I remember in the very first lesson I had Owen Ozzie Michaels, who I'm still training with at the dojo. And obviously a bunch of guys at Target are still there that I train with. And then otherwise, it's mostly guys at the dojo. But yeah, it's an interesting thing with training, because I've sort of shot through a lot quickly. I think we've just been able to go on shows, and that's sort of my strong suit is a lot of, I think I understood like what I needed to do quite quickly. I didn't have I don't know who I am, or, you know, establish any sort of character or anything like that. I already know that the fans are disgusting, so I can say that on a show. Immediately the fans don't like that. That's half my character already done. And then training wise, it's just a case of getting the reps in and doing, learning enough to have matches and, you know, go from there.
So talking of time scale then, you said it was AEW, and then that's kind of how that kind of spiraled into you.
Yeah.
To you coming in. So When did you actually, was it pre-pandemic, post-pandemic? When did you actually?
Oh, I think it was just pre-pandemic, I think. Right. Might have been a bit before then. I'm trying to remember. I'd gotten into a lot of documentary stuff. Then AEW was starting. Watched that for about a year, I'd say. And then yeah.
So I'm just trying to get a gauge. So you trained for a wee bit. When it came to the pandemic thing, though, when you started training more accurately, you're into the documentaries, into AEW, but is there anything that you started watching because of your training to keep to wrestlers that you thought, right, I could add a little bit of this from this person?
Oh, yeah. Again, mainly old school stuff because that's what I liked and that's what I knew I could do. There's loads of guys that can do a lot of the, you know, the flippy dippy stuff and, you know, all of the indie match stuff. I feel like going into it older than a lot of guys, I want to have that old school mindset of, you know, smart wrestling, if you want to call it that. So a lot of Jake the Snake Roberts, loved everything about that. Ted DiBiase, Million Dollar Man. Jerry Lawler. I watched a lot of Jerry Lawler stuff when I started training. I'd just basically steal moves for the most part of it at the start. You know, I'd be stealing fist drops, knee drops, any kind of drop. I'm staying away from the leg drops.
it's one of those things. It's one of those things where wrestling, especially if you maximize the little things, you can maybe hold off your bump card a little bit longer than you necessarily have to. Because you can just...
For me, it's got to make sense. Everything's got to make sense. And I can't... I'm not going to go off the top rope and do two backflips to then miss, like, and not even hit a guy. Lay there on the floor winded, and I'll be thinking, why did I do that? Mm-hmm. You know, I'd rather just clock the guy in the head or go up to the second and clock him with an axe handle or, you know, something like that. Because it's like... you can do an impressive move. But if you've not got a guy out, right, you've seen there as a fan, right? You've not got the guy out. You've done like four things to him throughout the match, and you're immediately hopping up to the top rope to do like a triple backflip through a table or something like that. And then I always sit there as a fan going, just move. And then the guy always does move. The guy goes through the table. He's laying there going, oh, and I'm like, it's, you know, there's a believability that's just ruined for me. Well, as soon as something stupid like that happens, I mean, it's cool. You know, you definitely get the, wow, look what he's able to do there. But I'm like, did you need to put it there?
That's surprising me. Like, this is going to sound really, really shitty, but I'm surprised you like AEW then. Because
I do sit and shout at the TV a lot, to be honest. There's been a lot of shouting at the TV. I mean, there's some stuff on AEW that I love. You know, MJF, everything he's done, I've been all for. FTR, obviously, again, they have a whole old school gimmick though, so that's probably cheating. But I think with some guys it works. You know, there's Darby Allin, where if you look at him, you know, he's Darby Allin. He's not a big guy. He's going up against, say, Billy Gunn. You know, he's like, for some reason now, the biggest guy in the universe. And it's like, yes, he's going to have to throw himself to get Billy Gunn down.
Yeah.
And that's where I'm fine with it. It's like, if Billy Gunn, however, was about to do a triple moonsault onto Darby Allin, I'd probably be like, why?
So most of the, if it's in context, it works. If it's logical. So yeah, like you said, Darby Allin, he takes reckless things because he's smaller. He has to. I understand your point. All makes sense. It's that Rey Mysterio thing as well.
If you've got the mindset right, you'll be absolutely fine in wrestling.
Mm. Absolutely. So moving on to your debut then, I've got noted down as 2022. So
might be right.
Sorry, muted to sneeze there. That's fantastic. I shouldn't have said that. No one would have noticed. So 2022 debut. I didn't write down who your opponent was because that would have been way too professional. So what do you remember about your getting that call? You got your first match.
Yeah, my first match was, have you not written down who it was, or have you not been able to find it?
I will go and search the big wide world. I'm assuming it was Target that you made your debut in.
It was, yeah.
Right, let's see if they're correct, because I've got to do the old control F to find it. You're on my list, honestly. I sent like 60 profiles, and I think they're slowly being added on.
Oh, it was the one. It was the one time I've gone out as a baby face, you know, wanting fans to cheer me. The one time it happened.
I've got November 19th, Damon Havoc versus Charlie Anderson versus Logan Reed.
That might have been my second or third match, but second, I think. First match I ever had was it was a tag match. It was me and Connor McGubbin. He's not really done that much at the moment, but he's on and off. Versus Medallion and Ivy Mist. That was the first one. I know there's a lot of guys at Target whose first match was with them too. And I mean, I did a beautiful sunset flip over the top rope, which every time I look at it, I'm like, I'm not doing that now. I was quite happy with the match, actually. It was all right. We lost, but we got a handshake. So that was the reins there. And then we'd had that match. I think that was just to test the waters with how I am on a show. I think I must have been training probably 3 or 4 months at that point. And then what was that match you said?
Triple threat, Damon Havoc and
Triple Logan. Threat. Yeah, I think it was a couple of triple threats or 6-man tags and things like that. I started off with a lot of them matches because obviously then, you know, you can ease your way into the way that it works rather than jumping headfirst into a singles match or anything like that. But a lot of my early matches were go in, get my stuff in, you know, hit my move. I can't remember if I won or lost that match.
The triple threat, it was Damon Havoc that won.
It was Damon Havoc. Yeah, okay. Yeah, I think I remember that. Yeah.
Whose guy, when I was during the pandemic and that, I went back and watched some full shows and Target put up quite a few. And Damon Havoc was a guy that was just like, God, why is nobody kind of maybe picked up Damon Havoc for a couple shows elsewhere? Or maybe he doesn't want to. That's his prerogative, yeah, I suppose.
I mean, my next match for Target's against Damon Havoc. He's always been sort of the expert target when it comes to anything, really.
He seems to be one of the guys that if there's someone coming into Target, it's usually Damon Havoc that you get. It's in your case it was Medallion as the kind of not gatekeeper is the right word, gatekeepers of Target. These are the guys you have to prove yourself against before you can move on to something else.
Yeah, I'd say so. Yeah.
So were you kind of fully formed? You said you kind of had the idea of the golden boy of hating wrestling fans being half the battle, because that's easy to get booed.
I mean, I just to be honest, I don't know how much of it I can say as a character. You know, a lot of stuff I've said and done on shows is just what I probably would say behind the curtain. I just say it louder, you know, and it works for the most part. The crowd can't stand me, which. Whether you like me or don't like me, I don't really care as long as you're making some noise.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I couldn't care less. But if you're going to wave sweets in my face, I'm probably going to hit it. You know,
that's the most important thing about, I mean, wrestling I like is generally that. Give me a bit of silliness, give me a bit of yay boo. I'm all in. I don't need the flips. It's cool to have the flips, but I don't need the flips. I just need a good story, and I will be yours for a good 20 minutes until like it goes on a bit too long.
I mean, don't get me wrong. If I need to go to the top rope, I'll go to the top rope. But if I'm going up there, I'm going to be trying to put the guy down.
So there's a couple of matches I did note as kind of big matches, considering your debut being 2022, spotted that in 2023 January you're in the ring with Josh Terry, who's now in NXT.
Yeah,
the Osborne.
Yeah,
and that was a right, like, I didn't realize he had signed until it came up, and I was like, hang on, there's Josh Terry. But no, he would get a big reputation in the UK, and you're talking about guys that could do the big moves, but could also could also work fundamentally.
He's one of the, for being in the ring with, he was probably one of the best for that, and especially for like the way he can do it. Just the way he moves in general, you can tell when you're with certain people, you know, it's like an athleticism that's like you've clearly worked on, but he's also probably always had.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to think of a spot that he did in that match. I remember him flying over the turnbuckle at one point, like Triple H, and I was like, you know, just to fly over like that, I'm like, that's graceful.
I know. Then you look at him and you find out how old he is. You just go, oh, that's disgusting.
Oh, it makes me sick.
It does. It's the same. I mean, I'd say it every time when I mention him, but same with Luke King Sharp. Every time I see him or mention him, I go, it's disgraceful how great you are at 20, whatever.
I think it's the same age as me.
It's just, it's ridiculous, but we'll get on to Luke King Sharp very soon, I'm sure, because we'll talk about the dojo and what have you, because I went back through some of your Facebook stuff and popped up, was it a year ago, the motivational team leader speech, so we'll definitely speak about that, because I was howling today watching it, because I watched it at the time, and then I kind of forgot about it, and I watched it again today, I was like, replay, because it was just incredible. Another match that I'll pick up at this point, again, still, a year in, you've got Martin Kirby, who's another...
It was a very fast year, honestly, it was like, I feel like you had to learn, because I just had match after match after match. So it was literally, I was scheduled to fight Martin Kirby and it never happened. The show got cancelled. I'm trying to think, I can't remember why. I don't know if it was a venue issue or if it was something like that. But I remember that match got cancelled about a week before it happened. But
I did wonder, I thought it was just something that the reps didn't get up again and put onto the website.
Yeah, I was excited for that, but yeah.
When it came to... When you started getting involved with Target, and you said you weren't that aware of a scene in the UK, was that then your kind of homework? Were you trying to find out more about shows about you? Were you traveling to shows to help out? What was
for the first for the start of it? I was just trying to have the occasional match, trying to get used to everything. I wasn't trying to get out there. Instead, I'd probably just hear from other guys, there's this thing going. Do you want to go to this? We did a show down in Burnley at one point. And then it was probably just during all of that, that's when LND Legends Ever Die, they told me about the dojo. So then asked me if I wanted to get a ride with them and then go and train up there. Which I obviously did. But it's mainly been weird timing for me. It's been just people saying stuff at me at the right moment and then I'll end up over there. Rather than me having to look up how many Scottish companies are there, hang on,
too many,
a lot.
We only cover
we've got all the acronyms; they're all taken.
I know. Oh yeah, I could probably just about get a whole alphabet going of of things going, and that's not even the ones. That's just the ones we cover. There's ones we don't for many reasons. So it's. I mean, just looking at that first year, 2 years. We're pretty much up to date in that. It's your career's you fit in a lot in the last 2 years.
It's been very full,
and including debuts. We'll speak about Legend Never Die, guys, because they've got loads of questions. Well, Fulton especially has loads of questions that we'll get into. But were they just guys you met on shows through Target and clicked with, or was there?
Through Target at the time. They were both training there. And then they've since transitioned to Dojo. Again, they both live in Scotland. But again, I met them through there. And then I don't remember speaking to them that much other than in training. So I was surprised, obviously, when I got a message asking if I wanted to come train with them up at Scotland. I just took the offer.
But if there's a seat in the car.
Exactly.
Go for it. It means that I'm rubbish with geography. So how long would that be a case for you to go to the dojo?
It's a 2-hour drive every week to get up there.
But, and then 2 hours back as well? Or...
2 hours back, yep.
I mean, at least the classes are only £5 a pop. So,
can't complain.
Definitely not. Especially when you've seen I mean, it's at girders, so there's also you get Lou, and then you got the off chance of a BT gun maybe hanging about and stuff like that. So it's a wealth of experience right there. I mean, even if you're lucky, £5.
I can't really say anything bad about anyone at the Dodger. Everybody's been good. In fact, for me in general, I haven't really had any issues with anybody in wrestling. But everywhere I've been, everybody seems to have been very nice.
It sounds like, though, that you kind of keep yourself to yourself, and somehow people just gravitate towards you.
I don't know how it works.
that's the best way, though. I feel like we're a bit of a kindred spirit that way, because if I go to shows and I'm in the crowd, I don't like speaking to people generally, but somehow people just kind of start speaking towards me. I'm like, oh, God.
Just start talking at you, you know?
Yeah. Which is nice, but you just have to live with a very awkward interaction for your life. So that's that's your fault at the end of the day. So we've got a couple of questions from Fulton and one from Sammy Sparks, which I think we'll end the Legends Never Die section with, because I'm very interested about it. So we'll start with Fulton King. Have you ever heard of Big Bubba Love?
Never heard of him. No. So I was working a camp show. And I was with Looking Sharp, I was with Fulton King, and was I with, I've done a couple, so I'm trying to remember who the third one was. I think it was Iron Drew on that one. And the rule for camp shows is you're never the same gimmick, you're never the same guy, you're never the same name. So we've turned up, I'm packing my things, you know, moving some chairs out of the way. And then Luke Sharp comes up to me and goes, "You're Big Bubba Love tonight." I thought, really? we come out very cool music. I'm trying to think. I think it was Enter Sandman or something like that. Very cool. We come out. I'm feeling sexy. I'm Big Bubba Love. And then Looking Sharp starts shouting at the woman, "You play a sexy song, play a sexy song," and then Hot Stuff starts playing, and then obviously turns into a, "Well, we can't not dance," you know, with this playing. And the crazy part is there was no mention of any of this happening. This all happened just off at the moment. I think Sammy was there as well. All three of us, me, Looking Sharp, and Fulton King, started dancing in sync, the exact same dance. I'm like, that's beautiful.
Yeah, the old, you know, the whole pump.
The old full Monty.
Yeah. I feel like going to a show with Lou is kind of like that generally.
Yes.
I feel like he's a guy that kind of sits in the car and just goes, like, you got the wee cigar in the mouth going, "I got the idea. Got an idea, guys." And then it just somehow all plays out into some sort of madness. Golden Boy, is it true the Great Khali taught you to throw the perfect overhand chop?
That's not true, actually. Great Khali doesn't throw the perfect overhand chop, and I'll tell you why. Great Khali's too tall. So if you can imagine, Great Khali's got a chop down like this, right? If a guy's already down there, you're chopping towards yourself. What you want to be doing is you want to be chopping to a guy that's slightly higher, roughly Fulton King height, because then you've got maximum impact on the cranium.
And then you don't lose any momentum on the downward
swing. Exactly, you don't move any momentum.
He's also asked, Golden Boy, where did you study your martial arts?
Well, first of all, I've always been, as I've mentioned already, a natural athlete. So, I mean, to be honest, I've used to do karate for the smallest time when I was younger. And then this is a short story, it's not relevant, but I used to train under the guy that trained Paul Newby, who was a karate champion at one time, and I believe what the story was is he fell out with a guy that trained him, who I was training with, and then that guy's dojo mysteriously burned down. So that's interesting, isn't it? But that's full on Cobra Kai stuff. But no, I just am the Kung Fu master. That is another one of the many titles of Golden Boy.
Master of Karate and Friendship for everyone, some may say. So last question that we have.
I taught Rossi Rascal everything he knows.
Last question we have from the Legends Never Die guys is from Sammy. Just tell the story about the airport line.
Oh. Right. I just want to preface this by saying I can't stand Sammy Sparks. Just want to get out there.
Anyone who Sammy puts in a question, nobody's, you know,
to hide behind a mask is a shame, is what I'll say, because it's disgusting. You know, nobody should be hiding behind masks. That's what I'll say about Sammy Sparks. The other thing is he doesn't shut up. So we were coming back from Denmark, and it was me, Sammy Sparks, and Stone Malone, right? And we're going through the airport, and you know where you get out of the plane, you've got to walk through about 2 miles, it feels like, of zigzagging around a queue. And Stone Malone's playing Booker T's theme song on his phone loudly. Sammy Sparks is just going, doing the LA night, yeah. Or shouting Stone Cold, what, every minute. And then this airport security woman comes marching through the thing. And I'm like, you had to open your damn mouth. And then she's like, can you three come with me? I'm like, what have you done? What have you done here? She escorts us through the whole queue. And then there's another guy that's walking with us. And he's like, oh, what do you guys do? He's like, oh, we're wrestlers. He's like, oh, yeah. We scan our way through and we're just through, just like that. I'm like, we annoyed our way through airport security. And well, that's how we knew we were in England. It wouldn't have happened anywhere else.
There you go. There's a
note. Must have heard us and gone, obviously, there. They're from here.
Oh, that's incredible. When you started that story, I was thinking, God, I would never want to be on a plane with Sammy and stuff. That's the behavior that we're dealing with.
To be honest, it was the back end of the trip. We'd been there, we'd done a show in, I think we'd done it in Sweden, and we're coming back. And I was just, I mean, I've said this openly to him, he was the same for me. After two or three days of seeing him, I was like, I want to see your face, Sammy. I'm sick of you. it was bad. And then by the time we was at that, we was just past it.
you're just numb to the
aye, yeah.
God. Anyway, right. Back onto the kind of journey. We've got Attitude Pro last year, September. So was this before or after the European trips? I'm assuming that was kind of organized through
this was before. In fact, I did an Attitude show the same weekend that I went away, I think, to Denmark, I think probably for the first time. But again, Mikey the Wanderer, met him at the dojo and sort of knew him from there. And then I think it was a Rumble that I first went to wrestle for them. And then I think I've been on one of his show. But yeah, I've never had a problem with him. It seems everything's always gone well. I enjoyed the shows. It was a really good venue that they had. I think it was, you know, packed out when I was there. It was a big crowd.
I've seen the pictures and they put up a show on YouTube and it does. It's just looks like a very intense crowd. They've, much like the Community Pro shows, they've got a very intense audience that are there to be entertained and see wrestling. So they like the, we'll go back to it again. They like the flippy stuff, but they like the characters. That's what I seem to get from the audience there. They like big characters like the Wanderer and the like, just to cheer people and boo people. That's all they want to do.
Again, Thatcherite as well. He was on the show, I think, and I remember that was one of the loudest boos I've heard in a while.
Oh, I'm sure I said this in a past podcast, but Thatcherite, he wrestled in Peterhead for Community Pro, so I went to Peterhead to watch it because it's not that far away from me. And I've never felt a venue go cold before. Like, literally, he came out, the wee piano ding, ding kind of thing of his music, and I've literally felt a shiver down my spine going, what the hell? And it was Thatcherite. It's got this like Undertaker vibe about him. Just suddenly my blood ran cold at the thought of a Tory.
God forbid.
Incredible. I tried to explain it, but I couldn't. It was just like, it's just, you have to see Thatcherite.
Yeah.
Right. He's a phenomenon. He's also a Tory. So
it's like Shawn Michaels in Canada.
Exactly. That's probably the highest compliment you could probably give. Right. But it's just, it was just so weird. I'll never I'll never understand it. And if they come up to Peterhead again, I'll see it again and be just as confused and a bit terrified at the same time. So yeah, new promotion and then off to Europe. That's quite a, again, quite a big thing to take.
Yeah, I've done a couple for CCW before changing to Valor. And then obviously through CCW is how I got over to Denmark and Sweden. And then I went to Denmark again, where I had a match against Gangrel. It was a tag match, but that was awesome. And yeah, it's just been the most packed couple of years, because it's just one thing after another, and then all of a sudden, you know, you needed for this and that.
Gangrel, I'm just gonna I'm hopefully seeing him in May, because he's coming to WrestleZone for Army Anarchy, and I'm so excited, because that's my kind of, like, they bring in like Scotty Hottie one year. That's my kind of era of wrestlers I want to meet. Met Billy Gunn, amazing. But Gangrel, so for yourself, that would have been just outside. I mean, you may have made one off appearance around about 2004 or something like 2005. So were you nervous to be in the ring with someone of the name value of Gangrel, or do you kind of just take every match as it comes?
I don't really get that nervous about it, because I just enjoy doing it. I was excited, obviously. It was a last minute call as well. It was the week before I got asked to fly off there, so it was like I just landed off the plane, gone to training, asked to go, had like the week, and then flew back out on my own this time, which was a lot nicer. I would recommend flying alone. And then I think it was in Helsingør, so I had to go across Denmark to get to there. And then by the time I got there, it was almost showtime. So we had to quickly plan through a match. And it's like, you don't register, you know, that it's Gangrel, obviously. But no, I loved it. It's an easy guy to talk to as well. I imagine there'd be some guys that are intimidating, but it was easy. It was easy to deal with. But yeah, no, I enjoyed it.
Oh man,
It was the fan that I'd had a problem with. It turns out I would have a problem with. In that, it was that same match, end of the match. I think Gangrel had won. And I was on the outside of the ring, and there's this guy starts helping me up. And so I see he's got a beer in his hand. So I snatch it and I throw it in his face. And then I look down and I realize that the beer's just gone all over my boots and everything. So I'm slipping over and I'm falling back. And I turn around and the audience member's taking his top off and he's like stood up staring at me. I'm like, oh, here we go. And he starts grabbing me and bashing me head against the ring. And like, literally the entire way out until the curtains, this guy was battering me. And then I get there and then everyone's like, he's not part of the show. I'm like, it's just some guy.
He was like, I'm a pro here. I'll just punch this here. This must be a thing, an angle. It's fine. And then, yeah.
A nice stiff worker. Guy, very nice. Ah, yeah.
Oh, amazing. So another note of my match I've got here is November last year, Rampage Brown.
Yeah.
Which again, we're people are they're listening to this, don't seem to, I don't think you're going to understand. You made your debut in 2022, and here you are in the ring with future NXT stars and like Josh Terry, Gangrel, and Rampage Brown, one of the most biggest and respected wrestlers in the UK. He's a guy that's not there for the flips. He's there for the logistic and just throwing people. Yep. So I'm assuming that was your evening for the most part.
Oh, well, you know, it was a tough one. But in the end, I was like, you know what, kid? I'll let you take this one. it was, again, a very intimidating guy. My brother came to that show, actually, and he saw me coming out. He's like, oh, Golden Boy's got this. And then Rampage came out. It was like, ah, maybe not. But, you know, I nearly had him. You know, there was a couple of points there, you know, where I nearly had Rampage. And that's to be noted.
I'm sure it'll be on YouTube somewhere. People going there.
Oh, it is. Yeah, it is.
Go check. Yeah. There'll be one or two gifts that
you've got. It's got a very nice pile driver.
Nice and snug.
Nice and snug.
Just thighs rest on your shoulders like a nice pillow before landing on your head.
Yeah, a nice sharp spiking pain, and then it's all over. You forget about all your problems.
For at least 3 seconds. It's all good. So I'm talking about, like I said, I'm talking about that this huge 2 years that you're having. Do you have like a bucket list? Is there things that you want to take off? I mean, you've wrestled in Europe, so I don't know if that would be one. You've wrestled established names, that may be one. Is there anything that you kind of have on a 5-year plan that you want to take off, or are you just taking it as it comes?
I'm just taking it as it comes. I don't really want to be, you know, one of the guys that's, I have to get to Japan, I have to wrestle this place, I have to wrestle that place, because chances are it could happen, you know. It's one of them that if you're just only aiming for one thing, how many other things are you missing out on?
Mm-hmm.
You know. So far, wrestling's been good, you know. So we're just going to stay at it.
Let's talk about CCW then, and well, Valor, as it's known now.
Or Valor, as it should be pronounced.
Valor. what I've got here is the CCW Copenhagen Cup semi-finalists, losing to Fulton King in the semi-finals. Win the tournament. But still, being able to just go, just to be trusted to...
That was my first time over there as well. I've had a match against Sebastian Day. I'd beaten him. Fair and square, I'd like to add. And then lost to Fulton King. But again, that was the first 18 plus show I'd ever done as well. So you can get away with anything on them, which is a nice change.
Was it one of those where you kind of had to train you got so excited with it, you had to train yourself back out of it when you came back?
Yeah, there's some things you just can't scream at kids, but there's some things that you want to, and you can over there.
Is there any, other than getting beaten up by a very snug non-contracted wrestler, has there any been throwback from a crowd that have not understood how wrestling is a performance in a show that you may have regretted at the time?
I mean, I'm not allowed to take food anymore to shows, I've been told. I had an incident with some biscuits, but that's all I'll say about that. And then to be honest, I haven't had that much. There's been, you know, the odd crowd member, Whitehaven. I'll say this about Whitehaven. The kids are feral, and they'll always, like, if you land anywhere on the outside of the ring, they'll nip and they'll stomp and they'll do anything. They'll try and do anything to you. Which again, I just say justifies me more if I'm honest.
Mm-hmm.
But no, other than that one time, the fans have usually stayed in the seats. They're loud. They're always loud.
You haven't been part of a inflatable hammer kind of onslaught?
I've snatched a few and thrown a few. I've snatched a few sweets and thrown a few sweets. You've got to act first. You know, you can't give them the chance.
Oh, I think Lou's probably been a victim of one, but I've watched many inflatable hammer attack, and I hate it. I just hate it. It's just, I start feeling bad for you.
I've been chopped a bit by the crowd. That's happened a couple of times, and there's always the odd crowd member where they'll chop you, and you'll think that really, you know.
I guess I saw
that
someone.
Was your moment.
I that's why I like being three rows back. I don't want to be trusted with that moment, because I feel like I'm going to absolutely ruin this, and it's going to be like, oh no. No, I don't want to do it too hard, because what if they hit me back and in that. But I've seen kids. I think I've seen someone chop one of the wrestlers in the throat as a kid, yeah. Punch them in the crotch. It's like, dude, man, it's a they can kick you back. You're not free of consequence in this. You know, you'd be tempted to, I assume. Anyway, so from that, Valor, you became the team leader. So I
was elected team leader. By the vast majority.
This was an incredible promo that I, like I said, I had to rewatch over and over again today because I just howled. It was very Brent-like. That was the kind of the vibe I was getting from it. It was the bit where you started playing Simply the Best and the guy stood up in the Celtic scarf. I was just gutting myself every time. I felt like, because of the way the camera was, how long did that take to happen? Because I felt like you had to do your bit separately for the most part.
It was the second take, I think. I think the first one, there's too many background noise. I was like, just go. I've got this. Just keep the camera on me and then turn it at the end. Oh, it was looking sharp.
Sat on the front. With a cigar again, just going, I got an idea, see?
Just clap it, slow clapping. But no, I enjoyed all being the team leader. Yeah, it was good. That was another good thing about going to the dojo as team leader, is I'm always looking out for my boys.
Do you find that when you go to like the dojo, I mean Target, they have some big characters and some really great wrestlers, but did you find going to the dojo that unlocks that kind of more character side, the stuff that you like a bit more because you had a guy like Lou and you had
it was kind of the same thing really because it was all at the same time. I just sort of thought, I don't really care. I'm being told I'm going to be a character. So as I started doing more stuff for the dojo and Valor, I did the same thing for Target. You know, I started just grabbing the microphone without telling anybody what I'm doing. cutting promos and doing things like that, and that's taken off for the most part.
I suppose it must be a bit of trust that Target have given you to do that, because anyone else, if you weren't doing your job right, if you do that once, you go backstage, you go, well, you're not coming back then, kind of thing. So at least
it was an all or nothing deal. It was,
yeah. So we'll go back to the questions briefly, and then I think we'll speak one of your biggest moments in your very short career shortly. But we'll go to the personification of greatness, Roy Storey, who I'm glad is asking questions because I think I may have offended him in the past. He's put, who's, I don't know if you've heard how I offend him, but anyway, who's the greatest wrestler you know?
Oh, see, I know what he's trying to get me to say, of course, personification of greatest Roy Storey, which he is. But I'd say out of current day rosters, you know what, I'm going to go, and I know he's not current, but obviously Gunther's current, Volta. He was my favourite modern era wrestler. Mm-hmm. Back when he was NXT, you know, on his long run, I'd say that was my top favourite. Followed, of course, by Roy Storey, of course.
Yeah, Roy Storey, who I when I was watching those Target shows, I went, is this guy supposed to be rubbish? And then he went, yes. Oh, cool. Like, oh God, that's not a good interaction. We'll eventually get Roy Storey on once I've eventually got that memory out of my brain.
Rebuilt your bridges.
Stranger things have happened. I've had wrestlers unblock me for reasons I'm not sure why, and they've unblocked me, so it's all good. It will happen one day, maybe. Roy, we'll get you on, and I will. It's just one of the things you always popped into. Again, it's a shower. Third time mentioning me having a shower. Sorry, people. It was when you just sit there and regrets and go, did I really just call out a guy going, is this guy supposed to be rubbish? And then go, oh no, he's seen it. I didn't tag him. He found it. So Roy Storey checks vanity searches. That's the lesson we've learned here. We've got Stone Malone asking, do we have funnier boys?
We do have funnier boys. See, this is again spending some time abroad with him and Sammy Sparks and being badgered to death. But you know, we always had funnier boys, and I just like to, you know, reiterate this. The odd little joke is absolutely fine as long as it's not coming from Sammy Sparks.
And finally, from the Twitter or X, wherever it's called at this moment in time, we've got James Blair in brackets, old school cool. He's done it in capitals, but it's like 9 o'clock. I'm not shouting it. If old school cool and Golden Boy shaked hands, would that be shook? Shaked hands, would the world explode?
It would melt steel beams, brother.
Oh my, right. So let's talk about probably one of the biggest moments that you've had in wrestling. Well, might not be in your opinion, but I'm saying it's going to be pretty high. Is obviously commentary with old school cool James. Oh, sorry, Jimmy the Ref, different guy.
Yeah, Jimmy the Ref.
I'm joking. It's the Target Wrestling High Octane Division Championship win against Logan Reed, one of your first opponents. That must be pretty cool.
Yeah, the crowd went up. Hang on, let me have a look where she is. Hang on. We've got it to hand. There she is.
Oh,
glory.
Nice.
Looking beautiful there. But it was, the fans weren't a fan of it, but you know what? I don't really care what they think. I mean, personally, I think she belongs with me, but you know, we'll see about that.
I mean, this episode's coming out in a month. This could be very awkward if
you. Oh well, you know, we've got some title defenses on us. You know, we've got Demon Havoc. You know, I've learned how long I've been wrestling him now, so I've learned all of his moves. Therefore, no chance. Sorry, but there's no chance. And also, who else is more golden to hold the gold?
It just makes sense, doesn't it? It's just right. But that, I mean, that title's been held by some of the Target greats and. You know, some of the outside. I mean, was Paul London a former high octane
champion?
Yeah, I remember rightly. So there's a good history for that title for those that have won it and have also went on to win the heavyweight title as well. Are you just going to concentrate on the high octane division, or is that a sight that you have going? Well, I've won this title. Maybe I can move on.
I'm going to go for every title. I'm going to go for the heavyweight. I'm going to go for the tag team division. If needs be, a push. I may even go for the women's belt. I need all of the belts. That is my goal.
Gender equality is 2024.
Gender equality. I'm going for them. Golden boys coming to town.
If you were to go get a tag team partner, I'm assuming Sammy Sparks is not going to be top of the list. But is there anyone that you've got your eye on? Victor Victorious. Would you be bringing him in? Would you be taking a Jimmy the Ref? For your interactions, or who have you got? Have you got an eye on someone for a tag team?
Oh, for a current tag team, I'm not sure. I'm going singles run at the minute. Obviously, I used to team with Chris Kendall. You know, that was always a good pairing. I had one match with Roy Story, Personification of Greatness. I've had a few other tag team matches. It's a different type of wrestling. It's tag team wrestling, and obviously, you got to think who are your opponents as well. I'm trying to think how many matches I've now had against LND. Mm-hmm. Probably too many to say for how long I've been doing it. So I'm enjoying a singles run.
Fair enough. Fair. Are you a title guy? Are you a guy growing up when you do a little bit of backyarding? You had the cardboard belts. Is that something that you take pride in being a champion, or just with being in a position in a company? Is it just
why get into wrestling if you're not trying to be champion, you know?
Exactly.
So, you know,
exactly.
If your name's the Golden Boy, you must be draped in gold. It goes without saying.
Yeah. Are you the kind of guy, I know you've got the belt there. I've just spotted the banjo. And that's I look at the camera, I try not to look at the screen, I caught it. Anyway, that's not important at this moment in time. It might be, but not at this moment.
Oh, it will be eventually.
I've lost my train of thought. Are you the kind of guy that just goes around the house? Why am I mentioning, I've got shower on the brain.
You've got showers just on the brain.
it's disturbing at this point. Are you the kind of guy that kind of just wanders around the house, title belt on? Post shower, just
daily, I'd do my food shopping with it. You know, I take this belt everywhere. You know, as I always say, it's about luchadors. I've seen them leave the house without the mask on. What's the point in being a luchador all of a sudden? You wear the mask.
That's it. You gotta go to Tesco and the full regalia.
Exactly.
Has to be done.
They need to know. They need to know that you're the champ.
The guy silver Mexico. If you're a luchador and you didn't wear your mask, it was disgrace to the sport, to the lineage. So you had to So yeah, so if you're in a shop near, I'm assuming Carl, I don't want to give you, I'm not going to dox you, but if you're near Kyle, watch out for I mean, do you defend the belt 24/7 or is it just got to be sanctioned matches?
Well, I mean, you know, it's just like with any sport, I have to be ready to put the belt on the line. I'm not just going to be 24/7 in it, but
fair. So
if it's announced, then I'll put it on the line.
So if you see him, you're not getting a title shot. You have to go through the proper channels. That's how it works. So from that, we'll go back to the commentary thing with Jimmy the ref. Do you know who shot Jimmy the ref?
I don't know who shot the Jimmy the ref.
I'm trying
to find out who shot Jimmy the ref, and I have my suspicions. You know, there's a guy that wears a red mask that I don't trust in the slightest. There's a guy in a black mask that I don't trust in the slightest. There's a guy in a black and gold mask that I don't trust in the slightest. If you're hiding behind a mask, you've got something to hide. That goes without saying. There's a whole faction going on in Valor right now called the Eastern Bloc. They don't look very trustworthy. You've got God's Country, who's gonna be packing guns other than a hillbilly religious squad, you know? God knows, there's a lot of suspects.
I feel like there's more suspects than innocents in Valor.
There is.
In
Valor, which sounds much better. I don't know why they didn't pronounce it as that in all of the shows.
Well, speaking of announcing, that you're on the commentary team. A little bit for Community Pro. No, it's the C in Copenhagen. I'm getting all flustered. In Valour, you're part of the commentary team. As someone who I've gathered through our chat here likes to talk, is that something that you kind of took to? Was there anything that you found? Because I tried commentary once to try it out, because I watched a show and I hated the commentary. I thought, I can do this. And then realized I couldn't. Was there a learning curve you had with?
Well, again, it was one of those things which I've been asked to do, because obviously, I think you know, Luke King's seen that I can do promo stuff and things like that, and I can talk on the mic and make some sense at least of things. So I think it went from, I don't really have any shame. I don't get embarrassed. I'll do anything, you know. So I don't care if there's a crowd sat in front of me. You know, I'll sit and talk loudly. but for the most part, it's I'll be honest, it's Jimmy the ref doing all of the stuff that needs to be said. I'm just watching a show and talking about it. You know,
he's got all the responsible.
He needs to know everybody's name. He needs to know every move's name. I don't worry about that. I see a guy beating up another guy.
I talk about like inspirations and you're picking up things here and there. Is that, again, something you just kind of maybe subconsciously taking in things through watching? You don't specifically look for commentators to go, right, I want to be a little bit like this or a bit like that. You kind of just be you.
I've always enjoyed it when it was like Jesse Ventura and things like that. But back then it was just guys shouting what's happening and, you know, just shouting random things. It wasn't as like structured. It wasn't as you have to say this and say that this guy's won this many. You know, at the end of the day, it's like, you can mention it when they're coming out, but who cares when you're in the middle of a match if you're saying, you know, this guy's been wrestling the area. In the meantime, he's taking a pile driver off the second roof. You know, you talk about what's going on. You know, you wouldn't watch any sports commentator and halfway through the match, it's like, oh, you know, by the way, did you know this guy's been, you know, over here and over here? You know what I mean? As soon as a match starts, you're calling a match.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, as soon as a match ends, you know stuff happens in wrestling. You know, guys run out of nowhere, security teams running, and your job is just to pretend that somebody can't see it. Mm-hmm. Just talk about it as it's going on.
So kind of you're even though you hate them, you're talking from the fans' perspective of just taking.
Yeah, I mean, I have a nice gap between me and the fans. I'm not sitting with them.
Deodorant.
I couldn't do that, but yeah, I've got a table and a bodyguard. You know, I'm not playing it unsafe.
that's absolutely fair. Like this end up just us talking about, ironically talking about showering and wrestling fans being smelly. There must be a correlation there somewhere that could
must be somewhere.
we did get one other question. It was through Instagram. Again, it was from old school cool James Blair, who's infiltrated all the social medias to ask some questions. He's put, again, he's put in capitals, and I'm not sharing it. Old school cool wants to know, .. Why is he so pretty? No, why he so pretty? Sorry, why he so pretty?
Oh, well, I mean, I was born the golden boy, so that's part of it, isn't it? It must be. Oof. I'd say it's genetics, but possibly not. I think it's just a one of kind anomaly.
As was the mustache, just
the mustache was always going to be. I feel like it was always going to happen. I'm glad it did.
I feel
and
like
the fans, it would seem, are not, but you know, I don't really care.
People can respect a good mustache. I feel like if I had just a mustache, I don't have the wideness of this bit for it. I would just look like I should be on a list of some description. If it has to be the whole beard, otherwise look like a thumb. It's just, this is the way it has to be. Although it's getting really fluffy. Anyway. Maybe if I had less showering and more beard care, that would be it. Why am I doing this? Anyway, right.
Let's talk about more showers.
Right, I want to know about the banjo. Because now I can't get it out of my head. Are you a banjoist? Is it there for aesthetic purposes? Are you learning?
I'm a recent banjoist.
Why?
Why not?
You're fair. That's sad. I mean, I can't really argue with that kind of logic. I mean, if I could, yeah, I probably would as well. But I'm just intrigued by it. I'm just bandying about here. Do you want to play? It's a bit late. I don't know if your neighbours will appreciate a tune.
What time are we on?
9:10.
I don't think I give a damn about my neighbours. I mean, we'll see if the microphone picks it up.
Oh yeah, there is that.
This is new, but you know, this is for all them. This is for all them marks out there.
First time we're getting a banjo play. I love this. I love the aesthetic in the background. We've got a record player, we've got a guitar, and we've got a banjo, and some lovely slippers. This is, I'm so excited. Right, fingers crossed. So hopefully,
this is gonna be playing out beautifully. It won't, but you know, they'll be expecting too much. You know, I'm only golden. Thank you very much.
Wonderful. I didn't think I was going to get a bit of Julian Banjos on a podcast anytime soon, and I'm so ecstatic. I don't think we can
go. Well, there's a first time for everything, isn't there, you know?
Don't think we can go any higher in this episode. But before we go, like I say, you haven't really met... You've really talked about having a bucket list. You just want to take it as it comes. But is there anyone in the dojo that you haven't had a chance to step in the ring with that you wouldn't mind having a wee tussle with?
I mean, looking sharp easily, I think I could have a good match with. There'd be a lot of shouting, I think. But that might be exactly what's needed. I think... Owen, Ozzy Michaels, never actually had a match on a show with him. I think that'd be a good one. To be honest, any of the guys from the dojo, Stone Malone. I think if there anyone else that would probably work for the style. I'd probably say those are the top three. That's out of anyone in the dojo.
Fair list, and you have to throw in a scissor kick or something just to get the memories of the Booker T. I'm assuming it was Can You Dig It, Sucker. It was the WWE one. It wasn't like TNA or anything like that, or just the King. Oh, the King Booker one. That would be even more irritating to go through with. Anyway, I don't think we're going to peak any higher than the banjo. So I think it's like we've covered the monumental rise so far of the Golden Boy Charlie Anderson. So we can leave anything else possibly for a future edition, but we've got a championship belt on the show and we've got a banjo, That's just...
Exactly. That's all you need. That's all you need. And if anybody knows anything about who shot Jimmy the ref, obviously goldenboycharlieanderson@gmail.com. Send me a message.
Speaking of plugs, get them all in. Where people find
that's the main one. That's the main plug. Send any information that you have. You know, obviously, if you spot a luchador in public, let me know about it. And yeah, come to the shows. Boo me, cheer me. I don't give a damn.
Wonderful. Well, this has been a fascinating chat. I'm so glad people have recommended you getting you on the show, because it's been an absolute eye-opener. Not just for the music, but I've really enjoyed hearing about your thought process and how your wrestling works out. And I think we'll have to go check out a Golden Boy Charlie Anderson match in the near future, live and in person, whenever that may be. You'll probably have to come up north for me to see it, but maybe one day. This has been a fascinating edition of the SWN podcast. Thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me this evening.
Thanks a lot. We'll be right back.